Visiting with Huell Hauser is made possible through a generous grant from the Ralph M. Parsons Foundation.
Hi, I'm Huell Hauser. Now, this particular adventure started a couple of months ago when we spent a day at the Long Beach Naval Shipyard. And part of that tour of the shipyard included a visit to the USS Antietam, which at the time was in dry dock. And during that visit, which was really unusual and wonderful for us, we had never seen a huge ship like this in dry dock before, we were invited by the captain of the Antietam, Captain Frank, to come back and visit him and his ship again once it got out of dry dock. So what we're doing right now, we're first going to take a look at that original program where we saw the Antietam in dry dock, and then we're going to come back for a follow-up, for an update on how the good old USS Antietam is doing these days. Okay, here's somebody official standing here to greet us. Hi, I'm Huell Hauser.
Good morning. Welcome aboard.
Now you are the, you're the commanding officer. You're the captain here.
Captain of the Antietam, that's right.
So you're going to give us a little tour of what's here?
Sure, be glad to do
that. What can we see?
Anything you want. What would you like to see?
Well, let's start. I don't know.
Let's go on.
I'm not sure I know what you got here.
Do you want to stay outside mostly, or you want to?
Yeah, I guess we'd like to stay outside so we can see the work that's being done here on the dry dock. Come on, John. Now, what is involved in dry docking a ship the size of this?
Well, Antietam is undergoing a $50 million overhaul. That includes the repair of equipment that's already on board, as well as the installation of a number of new systems to keep the ship upgraded and to keep it modern and able to operate at sea. This is what we call the forecastle of the ship, and there are a number of items going on up here, some by the ship's force, these are my sailors here, working on the helo nets, and by the shipyard on the top of this missile launcher.
So, do your sailors and the shipyard workers, they work together on this project?
Right, this is very much a joint effort. There are over 400 shipyard workers on the ship on the heaviest days, or have been, as well as all the shipyard people over in engineering and design and support services and in the shops, as well as the 350 members of my crew who spend about 60% of their time training and about 40% of their time doing industrial labor here on the ship. In addition to that, there's a whole team of people from the intermediate maintenance activity in San Diego, and we send them various pumps and valves that we don't have the capability to fix ourselves.
So you're really taking this ship down to its basics and bringing it back.
That's right. You can't see it now, but a 100-foot section out of the sides of both sides was cut completely out with new stiffeners put in. The paint has been removed virtually from the whole superstructure to put on these tiles to lower our radar cross-section, and that work started from the top of the mast and is coming all the way down.
Wow, this is quite an operation.
This is the vertical launcher here. The ship operates, of course, in salt water, one of the most corrosive kinds of environments that you can be in, and about every decade it's necessary to take these systems down to make sure they remain watertight. That's a big part of my job, is to keep the water out of the people tank.
Yeah. So you're really getting a new ship out of this thing.
Well, we are certainly going to have a better ship when we came out. And the ship was designed to last for about 30 years, but it requires a lot of care because of the environment that we operate in.
Now, how long are you going to be here? I asked John. I can't remember what he said.
Well, we started this overhaul on October 3rd, and we'll be leaving the end of June.
So it's a good 10 months.
Well, it's about what we'd call a 9-month overhaul, and we're getting a lot of work done. Great effectiveness here by Long Beach Naval Shipyard.
You'll be glad to get out to sea again, though, won't you?
Well, sure. I'd much rather be at sea than to be in the yard, but this is an important part of our job in the Navy, is to do these overhauls correctly, because our capital investment in this ship is huge.
Yeah. Now we're actually going down into the bottom of this huge dry dock, and I guarantee you, this is a perspective that most people never see. This is literally a ship out of water, Captain.
That's correct. We've been out of the water now for about 6 months, and there are things that we can only do in dry dock. For instance, there are 300 hull penetrations, that is, holes in the hull, or in the people tank, as I like to call it, where valves keep the water out of the inside of the ship. Those valves have to periodically be cut out with welding torches, then overhauled or replaced. In addition, the entire propulsion train of the ship has been removed from well inside the ship out here.
Look at this. Now this, look at the size of these propellers.
Yeah, these propellers, or screws as we call them, are really marvels of engineering, because these blades move back and forth, and that's how we get our reverse thrust, is by changing the pitch. So inside this large hub, there are large hydraulic pistons and lots of very fine tuned control systems. That all had to be disassembled, as well as the shaft.
Oh, look at the shaft. Yeah.
The shaft actually has long axial tubes that run in there to take the flow of oil to the hub, and a control rod, and also an air mechanism that blows air out of tiny holes in the surface of the screws to lower our noise in the water.
Look at all this work that's going on down here too. This place is a beehive of activity. Let's walk right through here real quickly. Oh, wow. Good morning. Now, what are you supervising? You look like a supervisor standing here.
Fire prevention.
Fire prevention. So are you a member of the crew or a member of the shipyard?
The shipyard.
So you're here to ensure that no fires break out during all of this welding that's going on?
Exactly. Yes, sir. That's my job.
Any fires lately?
Nope, we ain't having it.
Well, you're doing a good job.
Thank you.
And here we go over here, doing some welding up here. Boy.
That's right. These plates that they're welding on are the access into the inner boot. There's a large rubber boot that has to slide around the shaft, and that we keep it under pressure to keep the water from coming inside the ship.
Boy, this is an amazing sight underneath here. Looking up at the ship like this, it's a big piece of machinery, isn't it?
It certainly is. We're about 10,000 tons.
Does this, in a funny kind of way, I mean, I know you know a lot about what you're doing, but does this, seeing it like this, does this give even someone like you a new perspective on just what this ship is all about?
Oh, sure. Every time you come down in dry dock like this, I mean, you learn something about the ship, or you do get a different view, because in the water, it's nothing like this at all. I mean, it's more like a sports car, and here you can see what a huge piece of machinery it really is.
Yeah. Wow, this is something. Ha! Standing in the bottom of a dry dock underneath this huge ship.
I might add one thing some of your viewers might be interested in, because I frequently get asked, when you paint the hull, which is what we've done here, what do you do about the spots where the supports are holding the hull up, and how do they get painted?
And what do you do?
Well, the next time we come into dry dock, we'll actually put these blocks in a different location, so when we paint the hull next time, we'll be painting the spots that are now blocked.
So you mean those spots go unpainted until the next time?
Well, it has the, whatever the original paint job was,
right,
is on there. And there are three docking positions. So over the cycle of the ship, dry docking, the blocks go in three different locations. So everything gets painted.
Now this is something. We are literally directly underneath the hull of this massive, how heavy is this ship? How many tons?
10,000 tons.
Now what would happen? An earthquake hit with...
Well, actually, I can answer that, because I was in this dry dock on a battleship back in 1989, and when the earthquake, Long Beach earthquake, took place, and it shook the ship pretty good, but it's very solid on these blocks, and there's a lot of weight holding it down. The bottom of this ship's a little bit rounded, But you can see everything's form-fitted. I don't think anything would happen to the ship.
Because I got to tell you, I am putting a lot of faith in the strength of these things right now, because we are literally standing underneath this ship.
Well, that's right. But, you know, the ship is being supported much in the way it's being supported in the water, because the water is acting with the force on the hull of the buoyancy of the ship. And these blocks are spread out across the whole length of the ship and the width to make sure that no individual block is taking more weight than it has to.
Okay, you've reassured me. Yeah. I feel better already.
Okay.
Well, it was just a question. It wasn't a bad question, was it?
It's an excellent question.
Be just my luck for an earthquake to hit while we're standing underneath
there. Our biggest danger in an earthquake situation would probably be that the caisson, which has a huge amount of water against it, there was some damage around the outside of the caisson and the dock flooded, because right now the water would go inside the ship. We don't, all of these valves and so on are open.
Wow. Well, that's a problem we're not going to have to deal with, right?
I hope not.
Got enough problems without worrying about an earthquake. Boy, this is something. Let's see what these guys over here are up to. Good morning. How y'all doing? What are you working on over here?
We're disconnecting the temporary services for the ship, so so we come out of dry dock.
So you mean the whole time they're here, they're hooked up to some kind of cord that gives them the services from shore?
Right, auxiliary power, right.
So this power is what's running your ship right now?
Right. We usually will take power from the shore when we come into port to save on our fuel cost instead of making it ourselves. However, in the shipyard, temporary services is your lifeline, both for the industrial work and for lights and power, because they have to bring in air, they have to bring in welding leads, they have to bring in ventilation. The ship itself does not have any of its normal air conditioning systems running. So these guys bring in everything we need on board to work.
Now what's this big tarp doing over here?
This tarp is covering our sonar dome. The sonar dome on this ship is like a big rubber radial tire. In fact, that's the way it's constructed. And this is just part of the protection system for the sonar dome, because we don't want to get it damaged in any way. Any imperfections in it cause noise in our anti-submarine warfare systems.
So this is your sonar down here?
Correct, yep. It's actually covered up here with a protective surface. Underneath that paper, you would see a rubber, looks very much like a rubber, smooth rubber tire.
Why would I have thought that would have been on the top of the ship instead of underwater?
For sonar sends out sound in the water to look for submarines, we operate it down in the environment where the submarines lurk.
And here's the door that opens up to let the water in.
Yeah, this is called a caisson, and it's like a dam or a door, and of course the water goes right up there to about the 42-foot mark on the caisson door, and you can see a little bit of leakage under the bottom of it, but it keeps pumped out pretty well.
Well, thank you very much for the tour.
You want to see the anchor chain over here?
Oh, yeah, look. Painted four different colors.
Yeah, the red shot is the one that goes all the way inside the ship. Each shot is 15 fathoms long, fathom 6 feet. And the red shot's the last one. The yellow is caution. And the black shots are the ones that we normally have in the water. The white ones are between shots to tell us how much chain we have out in the water. So if we're in real deep water, we might get out to the yellow shot. If we ever get to the red shot, we know we have big problems, because the chain is not connected to the ship at the bottom. It's just in a locker and wrapped around a Wildcat. That's what controls it. It's not linked inside the ship in any way. So if you lose control of the chain, the whole thing could just run right out.
I don't think I've ever seen an anchor laid out like this before. That's a lot of chain.
Yeah.
How much chain you got there?
Well, there are 12 shots, and each shot is 15 fathoms, and each fathom is 6 feet. So it's 12 times 15 times 6.
Well, thank you very much for the tour. This has been great.
Glad to have
you. I think this is something very few of us have ever seen, a ship this size in dry dock. Well, that visit to the USS Antietam in dry dock in Long Beach took place several months ago. Now we're at Naval Station San Diego. Captain Frank up there on the bridge has invited us to come on board the Antietam and go out to sea, now that it's out of dry dock, to see what it's like on board the Antietam when it's fully operational. Good morning.
How you doing? Welcome aboard.
Thank
Mighty
you.
Mighty glad to have you back in Antietam. Hi.
Well, I tell you what, it's a little different than it was the last time we were aboard.
It certainly is. We're underway now and have a whole lot of evolutions going on today for you to look at. More than I can even count now, with midshipmen and guests and activities and gun shoots and unreps and all sorts of things to do. And I'm going to have my public affairs officer show you whatever you want to see.
Yeah, the captain has already told us we are welcome aboard, but that he's really too busy to spend much time with us today,
yeah,
right?
I'm afraid I'm not going to be able to spend a lot of personal time with you today, Hill, but I hope to see you a little bit later on.
Officer,
secure the CNA
anchor detail.
Secure the CNA anchor detail, officer. Boats, secure the CNA anchor detail. Set the number on the way watch.
Secure the special CNA anchor detail. Now set the number on the way watch. On deck, watch section 1.
031, which one?
Now this is a
bosun's whistle.
Or a bosun's pipe, bosun's whistle.
Yes, sir.
Now this looks and sounds like the old Navy, like something you would have heard a couple of hundred years ago on Navy ships.
Yes, sir, you would have. Back in the old times, back during World War II, they used the bugle, and then now, to later, today's Navy, we use a bosun's whistle, or a bosun's pipe, to where we can communicate through the ship with different tunes, letting the crew know that, hey, we're going to have chow this time, or an all hands, or secure from something, which you've seen me in the bridge a little while ago, secure the crew from seeing anchor detail.
That's what you were blowing just a minute ago.
Yes, sir.
Now, do you have to go to a school to learn how to do this?
No, sir. It's just on the job training with through our chiefs and our first classes that we have to go through, that we have to learn and pipe in front of him before we can come up here and stand bridge watches as boatswain mate of watches.
Are you musically inclined? Do you play any other instrument, or is this it?
This is about it, sir. This is about all I blow around here on the ship.
Well, can you do it for us? Can you give us a couple? Let's see what, you know, like for chow, what would that be?
That one's a minute and a half long. You sure you want me to do that one?
You have a minute and a half long call for chow?
Yes, sir. A minute and a half.
Why a minute and a half?
Navy tradition.
Can you give us the first 15 seconds of the chow call?
I can make it shorter than that, sir, because it's long-winded.
Okay, give us just a quick chow call. Now, do the crew members, they have to learn what all of those various whistles mean, don't they?
Yes, sir. Some of the senior members of the crew from our E4 up will know what these tunes are if they have been on previous ships.
Yeah.
Some of the newer crew will have to go around and ask, hey, what was that whistle for? And they'll ask, and we'll tell them what it's for.
Boy, it has a melodic sound to it. It also has a loud, piercing sound to it.
Yes, sir, it does. What we do is when we get the pipes, we have to saw, they're cut right here.
Hold that up so we can take a look at
they're
it.
Cut right here when they're made. What we have to do as boatswain mates, we have to put solder on them and fill it up at a 45 degree angle with beeswax.
So there's beeswax in there?
Yes, sir.
And I guess in the old days, they didn't have an intercom system to communicate to the ship like you're doing, so you would have been just your own natural sound would have carried through the whole ship.
Right, sir. That's the way that they communicated through the ship to let the crew know what was going on for that day and what they had to do for that day.
Can you give us one other, give us another one that's totally different from the one we just heard?
Okay, sir. The one that we usually pipe for announcements over the YMCA will be attention to the crew, which you'll all know. Get their attention, and let them know that the word's fixing to be passed about something that's going on in the ship.
There's an announcement about to be made.
Right, sir.
Wow. Well, this is very interesting. Thank you very much. This is something I had no idea that something like this still went on aboard ships. Does this go on board all Navy ships today?
Yes, sir, it does. Some of the ships, depending on the COs, some COs think it's an annoying little whistle that the boatswain mate shouldn't have, but some COs still carry on the tradition like Captain Frank does. He likes to carry on the tradition of the old Navy.
So he's known as a traditional Navy guy?
Right, sir.
Do the crew members like that?
Yes, sir.
You think they like the tradition?
Yes, sir. I'm third generation of the Navy, so I'm here today to tell you that I'm enjoying myself here.
Now, what's going on here?
Well, sir, what we're doing, we've got a little bit of DC Olympics going. We've got these gentlemen putting on ensembles, firefighting ensembles. They're just racing to see which crew can get in the fastest. After they get that done, they're going to connect hoses to the fire plug over here, run them out over to that side, and discharge the nozzles off the side. First team done wins.
Now, this is your regular crew over here. These are the visiting midshipmen over here?
These are our visiting midshipmen. These are our visiting sea cadets.
Oh, okay.
So we have no regular crewmen up here right now.
Now, how important is this on the ship, this firefighting ability?
Extremely important. We practice on a weekly basis and on a nightly basis with the import sections at sea, a weekly basis with the sections on board the ship.
In case there's a fire on board.
Yes, sir. We try and have our teams dressed out in about 5 minutes and ready to enter the space to fight the fire.
So how are they doing?
They're at 1 minute right now. They're doing pretty good.
Yeah, they're almost ready, aren't they?
And the midshipmen over here are doing a lot better. Good teamwork.
Well, that's part of it, teamwork. How are they doing?
Doing pretty good. A little confusion on the hoses, which ones they need to get connected. We got to try and put two males together there.
Oh!
And it looks like they're about to shoot over the side. Let's head over that side.
Here they go. Here it goes. Now, how important is it to have these midshipmen on board? And you've also got four people from the Naval Academy, right?
Yes, we do. We have a first-class midshipman from the Naval Academy that embarked for the summer. But we have these midshipmen here. They're just getting ready to start their sophomore year in various universities throughout the country. And the career orientation and training of midshipmen is very important so that we go in for the day just to pick them up, bring them out here, give them some at-sea experience.
So the whole idea is to take it out of the classroom and let them come on board and see what life is really like.
Right.
On a day-to-day basis.
That's right, and they get to experience life out sea out here just for a day for today.
Now, do you sanitize it? Do you sanitize it for them, or do you let them see what it's really like?
Oh no, we show them the true face.
I'm just curious what your feelings are about being out here today. What you've seen so far.
I'm impressed with the
Hang
ship,
there,
the people on it. I mean, I don't know. We've been on other ships. The one yesterday was kind of, I don't know. I can't even compare.
You're on the best right here, right?
Well, just repair it, and it's the best now, yes.
Yeah. Now, you'll take this knowledge, this practical knowledge that you're seeing today, back to the classroom and use it in a different way next year, right?
Not necessarily back in the classroom, but later on in life. I mean, the classroom is just basically preparing us to be better officers, but this is far better in a classroom because it gives you the hands-on training. I mean, you could read about a ship, but there's nothing compared to actually being on it.
Yeah, so you're having fun and learning.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
We're all having fun. If you're not having fun, you're not doing it right, so.
There's a big difference between learning about it in a classroom and being out here on something like this.
Oh, yes, sir. It's very much different because I had never been on a surface ship before. And I was like, okay, yeah, I can do it. But I had to take seasickness pills earlier just so I could be up here today.
Really?
Yes, sir.
Well, now, wait a minute. If you're going in the Navy, you can't get seasick.
I took the scholarship. I didn't know much about it.
Are you seasick?
Yes, sir. Actually, I was the second one in line to pick up those seasickness pills. So that's why we're here together, sir. Sir.
That's why you're staying next to the
rail, yes, sir.
Yes, sir. We had a good view of the horizon, so we can keep our equilibrium kind of more or less
uh-huh,
intact.
Uh-huh. So. All right. Well, congratulations.
Thank you,
these are the guys who won the competition.
Thank you, sir.
With the hose there.
Thank you.
That was amazing. What is this thing?
It's a close-in weapon system. It's designed to shoot down incoming missiles and airplanes that are offending the ship.
Now, what did we just hear over here?
That was about 150 rounds gone in about 2 seconds.
In how many seconds?
About two.
150 rounds in 2 seconds?
Yes.
Now, what is your job? What are you...
My job is to act as a safety observer. We're looking for any boats or anything that might be out in the ocean that we might hit. We'll immediately stop the firing then.
I guess that is, you should make sure there are no friendly craft out there, right?
It could get kind of ugly if there is.
Now, what's the range of this thing?
The range of this is about 11,800 yards, which is just shy of 6 miles.
Wow. And we're all wearing these earplugs. I guess you have to have earplugs, don't you?
Pretty much, because anything above 84 decibels, you have to wear hearing protection. Otherwise, you start losing hearing.
And how high is this one?
Roughly about 120 to 130.
Really? Now we've come up here to the, what area is this?
This is the 05 level aft. It's normally a secured area, but we're up here to observe the shooting of the close-in weapon system.
Now I haven't seen this thing fire yet, but I've heard it from the other side of the ship when it fired the first time.
Well, you know when it's going off because it's shooting off an awful lot of rounds right at the same, right, very fast.
This is an amazing weapon you've got here.
Thank you. It's our last-ditch defense effort, really, for an incoming missile. If the missiles that we have on board and the guns don't shoot it down, this is a short-range, 2,000-round...
2,000... Captain. 10 seconds. He always gives a countdown?
No, he doesn't. This is just so we can get it filmed good.
Okay.
5, 4, 3,
oh boy.
2, 1. Batteries released, mount 22.
Whoa!
And those bullets leave that round, and they actually track themselves. They track the bullets in a closed-loop tracking system, and they track the incoming missile, and they move the bullets to the missile to destroy any missile before it gets to the ship.
That's about as high-tech as you can get.
Well, it's been proven to be a very successful weapon system, and we have it on all our ships. So.
You know, it's amazing. All of the guys from the ship have come up to see it, too. So this is a big deal, even for the guys stationed aboard this ship to see this.
It's a little bit of the gee whiz. You know, the guys who are down cooking and operating the plant, they get to see something different. So, yes, it's a show.
Wow, and my ears are ringing through the earplugs.
That's quite loud, you're right.
Whoa. Now, as we came down from watching all this high-tech stuff, here's the Navy that so many people know and love right here.
Yes, sir. This is just basically the way we stow it so that it... You know, the swabs don't rot, anything like that. We still got to clean the place, you know, no matter where it is, no matter what we do, we've got to clean.
So no matter how high tech the missiles or the decoys or anything else get,
you get back to me.
The good old mop is still with the Navy.
Yes, sir.
You're still swabbing the decks.
Every day. Every day. If it ain't clean, it ain't good. We got to make sure it's clean. We treat this like it's our home, because it is our home when we're away, and we just got to keep it clean.
Is anything going to ever replace this?
I don't think so. Not anytime soon.
We've never come up with anything.
No, sir. No, sir.
We've never come up with anything to replace the...
No, that's still the best there is. Comes the swab of the deck.
We were just commenting the swab, the mops will always be with us.
They will. We need to have clean decks. The XO's job is keep the ship clean, so I like those swabs.
He loves those swabs.
What?
He loves those swabs. He tells us about it every morning.
Okay, now we're going into the galley. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Welcome to the Snake Bite Cafe Galley. The Snake Bite Cafe Galley.
The Snake Bite Cafe Galley.
Where did he get that name?
My predecessor and the supply officer at that time came up with the name. They were going up for a food service competition.
Uh-huh.
The snake on the hat, Snake Bite, and that's just kind of how it came about.
Well, that doesn't have a very positive connotation, but your food here, I've heard, is excellent.
Oh, yes, we are. We're known for our food. It's all because
how are you known for your food?
We've won the Edward F. Ney Award That's a award for food service excellence. That was a Navy-wide competition. They look at our records, they look at our food, and at the quality of people we have working for us.
Well, let's look at what we've got over here, what we're having for lunch today. What are we having for dessert?
We're having chocolate cake and apple pies when we break it out.
Uh-huh.
Got fruits, cottage cheese, and everything else.
Now, did you make, which one of these things did you make?
Well, we have a night baker that bakes, uh-huh. And they the one that do all the baking around.
Well, what is your specialty?
Our specialty is over here.
Uh-huh.
All right.
Well, show me your specialty. That's what we want to see. What have we got here? We've got
all right, we have the Polish sausage.
Polish sausage.
And we have the burritos.
Burritos.
Mexican rice. Scalloped potatoes. Carrots. Succotash. And beef barley soup.
So that looks like a pretty good lunch to me.
Yeah. But this is to me, this is our average lunch. We could do extra, you know, better than this right now.
Like, what's your favorite? What would be the best lunch you could give me?
I say lobsters, steaks, teriyaki steaks, potatoes.
You have lobster here?
Lobsters.
In the Navy?
Yes, we do. Yes, we do.
How do you break the monotony of day-to-day eating on board here? How do you vary the menu?
Well, with color is for one thing. Uh-huh. We have like 1,200 items that we can cook in our system.
On board this ship?
Well, if we don't have it on board, we can get it.
Uh-huh.
So it's no problem. And then our color texture is a big thing. You gotta have our different colors.
And you have it all kind of fixed up. This looks really kind of she-she up
12 here. Different ways you can make rice, at least 12. So we make it every other day, something different.
A different way.
And of course the decorations really add to it.
Mm-hmm.
And we have some good people that really know how to decorate.
Wow. That's amazing. I don't know why I'm surprised. I guess most people would be to see this kind of food service on board a ship.
We have the best fruit too. I've been in my fourth ship and
let's take a look at this. What do you mean you got the best fruit?
Well, we get like 7 or 8 different kinds, and we even have fresh strawberries some days, and you won't find that on many ships, fresh strawberries. And I came from Guam and we couldn't get hardly anything overseas, so I'm really proud of my fruit here.
Now, is this ship an especially hungry ship?
Seems like it. We have a good PT program, uh-huh. excellent PT program, so they stay fed, but they work it off too.
So you can tell that these guys are working out because of their appetite.
Yes, sir. That's true.
Now, you were also telling me you're allotted a certain amount of money per day, per guy to feed.
A little over $5 a day.
So for $5 a day, you have to feed 3 or 4 meals to each person on board.
That includes your mid-rats at night. Mid-rats, we have a mid-rat meal that we feed people that's on watch and all. So that's 4 meals.
So this is a constant thing going on here.
Yes, sir. After we clean up, we start making another meal and we put it out.
If you had one thing that you could give me to eat today that was your specialty, what would it be?
My potato salad.
Your potato salad?
I have real good potato salad, but my wife don't like it. Too much mustard, but I love it. I've never had a complaint in the Navy with it, but I don't have any right now, but I will make some.
I understand you did something interesting while the ship was in dry dock.
Yeah, we're in dry dock. The captain sent us to study with some chefs, and we got certified by the American Culinary Federation. Right now, I'm a certified cook. It's a nice stepping stone going to become an executive chef or master chef, hopefully. It helps out in our careers.
So when you leave the Navy, you're going to become an executive chef in some fancy restaurant.
Yeah, hopefully, eventually.
Now, are you going to take your ability to cook these potatoes? Tell me about these things right down here.
These are Irish potatoes and a nice white cheese sauce.
Uh-huh.
So, just a little something different for the crew. Normally we slice up our potatoes or, give them a red skin potatoes or a nice Idaho potato, but today we use a little Irish potato.
Now, being in the military, did someone have to peel those potatoes?
No, the days of the peeling potatoes aren't thoroughly through, but they're pretty much through. We got canned potatoes and we're able to get enough fresh potatoes, so. we need to do the peeling, we have a peeler over there, so no more the days of the big pile of potatoes and the peelers.
Yeah, because that's the image we all have, a bunch of guys sitting around peeling potatoes.
Yeah, it doesn't happen anymore, so.
Those days are gone, and the executive chef days are here in the United States Navy.
Yep.
Well, congratulations. I look forward to coming to your restaurant someday.
Thank you. You're invited.
Now, this is interesting. We are approaching a submarine. What is the etiquette when two Navy ships pass like this?
Well, when we're operating here during daylight hours, we have a long tradition of rendering honors, we call it. The captain of the Topeka is a junior to me by quite a few years, probably about 10. And he should initiate the rendering of honors by calling his crew to attention and saluting, and we'll do the same thing over here. And we'll do that using whistle signals to call the crew to attention to port, hand salute, ready to, and then carry on. And he'll do the same thing over there in response.
And really, all of that is just a courtesy. There's no practical use to that. It's just a Navy tradition that continues.
It's a Navy tradition and a military courtesy. Of a long period of history, naval ships have used various forms of saluting one another.
Would it ever, I mean, it would never not happen, would it?
Well, we don't do it at night, generally, and we don't do it when there's wide separation between ships, but in those cases, the ships normally would send me a message requesting permission to proceed on duties assigned.
Yeah. Okay, so we're coming right up next to it now. That's a beauty.
Yeah, that's a beautiful sub, one of the Pacific Fleet submarines homeported here in San Diego.
Obviously it's a nuclear submarine, and
yes, we're only operating nuclear submarines now in the U.S. Navy.
Wow, look at that. Now, how's he going to salute us if he does?
Well, we're going to have to listen up for him to have to listen for his whistle signals and watch. Attention to port. Ready to?
Two vessels, folks.
Carry on.
Three whistles, folks.
Wow, that's really quite...
That's how we do it.
Yeah. But it has a nice feel to it when you do that.
Yeah, it's very much like when officers or the crew members and officers salute one another on the... on the beach.
Yeah. And there it goes. You know what's so interesting about this is that the ship is so different than it was because there's so much, I mean, it's alive now.
That's right. After 9 months of work in the Long Beach Naval Shipyard, we've really been reborn and we're newer and better than we were with all the repairs.
And since we last met, the Long Beach Naval Shipyard has been designated for closure.
Well, that's true. The president has now signed the piece of paper and sent it for Congress, which will undoubtedly make the final approval on the closure of all of the bases.
So how does it feel having one of the last ships to pass through that historic facility?
Well, of course, I'm mighty glad to be back at sea, but I can only say the finest things about the Long Beach Naval Shipyard, who had 400 men on the ship and thousands more in the yard who worked with my crew to achieve a really stupendous overhaul, in that we completed on time and under budget.
Yeah. Under budget.
That's right.
That's the key word we taxpayers like to hear.
And one that we're very interested in as well.
You know, when we first walked in here, there's a real sense of that you kind of wanted to speak in a lower tone, because you realize quite quickly that this is a serious place up here.
Well, that's right. We try to keep it quiet and have people pay attention to their duties, but we're doing a lot of training of new personnel as well. A lot of the people have come aboard while we were in this 9-month overhaul, and this is actually our first time coming down to San Diego for exercises since we left the shipyard, so it was a new experience for most of these people.
So you're training, a lot of these are new crew members.
Absolutely. I'd say probably half the people up here on the bridge have never been up here for sea detail before.
Now, how complicated does that get for you? You're used to working with a certain cast of characters, and then a new group come in.
It's not terribly complicated. It just takes a lot of patience.
Yeah, because, I mean, the rank structure is the same, but you really have to get to know the people, too, don't you?
Well, that's right, and they have to learn their duties and become qualified and then become really, truly competent. And I go in where I have to go in, and I sit back in my big chair there on the bridge when I can sit back.
Where is your big chair? Can we take right a look at it? Do you just have one big chair, or are all of these big chairs yours?
No, this one's mine because this one has the most instruments that I can tell what the ship is doing, and has my communications panel. And so I stay out of the way of the junior officers over here and kind of monitor what they're doing. And then when I need something, I usually try to signal them with my hand, turn left or turn right or go fast or slow down, so I don't add to the noise level. But we try to work together and make a real team here.
And how frantic does it get in here if and when something might go just a little bit unplanned?
Well, we try to keep everything under control, but things do occur. Unplanned activities come up, and actually part of our training is to deal with these emergencies as they arise, or unforeseen emergent events as they arise. And we run drills continuously from watch to watch in how to deal with the loss of steering, or the loss of an engine, or a fire, or flooding, or any of the hundreds of electrical casualties that could occur, all of the many things. And then, of course, there's also the other drivers. As you've seen while we're leaving port, there are many ships and boats, and we have to drive defensively.
Well, can we walk out here for just a second? Now, is the ship running better than it did before? Can you tell any difference at all since it's come out of dry dock?
Yes, I can. It is running much better in several aspects. One, we cleaned the hull while we were in dry dock, so we can actually go faster now and use less fuel to achieve our cruising speed. We have some instrumentation and some fine tuning that was done. It was like getting a major tune-up in your car, and we're able to achieve better efficiency in the operation of the plant. In the electronics and the combat systems, we have new capabilities, and these we're really just testing out. We've only begun to scratch the surface of the new capabilities that we're trying to use.
So is this one of the first times you've been to sea since you've come out of dry dock?
This is the second time we've been to sea since we came out of dry dock. The first time was just for a sea trial, simply to see whether we could get underway and get back into port. And this is the first time we've actually gone out to do naval operations as opposed to just a test.
So we know everything works.
Nearly everything works.
Whoa.
Now we're going to see firsthand just how maneuverable these ships are.
That's right, Huell. Right now we're going almost 30 knots, and I'm going to demonstrate some maneuvers to you that we could use in a warfare situation, because these ships were built for high speed and a lot of maneuverability. It's kind of a sports car of the cruiser world.
Well, let's take a look at this. What exactly are we going to see?
We're going to make a full rudder turn now at almost 30 knots.
Oh, wow. So we are, this is something old Navy guys would appreciate, wouldn't they? Oh, look.
I think so.
Look at this, Louis. Oh my gosh. Whoa. So you can really turn these things on a dime.
That's right. Our radius at this speed is a circle that's about half a mile in diameter, a little more than a half a mile in diameter.
Wow. How does this compare with some of the older ships?
Well, this ship turns in just about the same circle as an older ship, but part of the design characteristics. But the gas turbine engines give us a great deal more maneuverability in terms of how fast we can reach our top speed and how quickly we can back down. So after we finish the circle and build back up speed, I'll do what we call as a crash back and show you how quickly the ship can stop, and then we'll move ahead and you'll get to feel the sports car-like acceleration.
Because I'm holding on right now. We are really tilted down.
Yeah, we have a pretty good heel here.
Louis, can I help you get up here, Louis? Let's get Louis up here and let him look out here. Wow. And what is this behind us that you were talking about?
Well, this is the wake behind us. We call this white water behind us, all of the bubbles caused by cavitation of the ship and the screws moving through the water.
Well, remember, we were walking under the ship when it was in dry dock and saw those propellers.
That's right. It's a nice, clean haul now, so we can make real good speed with great fuel efficiency.
Well, tell us what we're seeing back here.
We got twin screws back here, both producing, I don't know how fast, going about 20 knots right now.
Get up here to the edge here. Louis, come on up here.
Twin screws, one's here, producing about 20 knots worth of speed. Most of the water that you see kicked up is by our prairie air maskers, which mask the noise. We put out a lot of bubbles into the water, keep our noise so submarines can't hear us down. So a lot of this water that's kicked up is from the bubbling from the prairie air masker.
Boy, this is beautiful back here.
It's a lot better at night when we're in the Indian Ocean, you see the water glowing.
Really?
Yep. The stories here about the water glowing in the Indian Ocean is true. The water does glow at night.
Now, how is our water here in Southern California?
Once we get outside the harbors, it's pretty clear.
Uh-huh.
San Diego Harbor, it's not so good. Long Beach Harbor, not so good. But once we're out, it's clear.
See a lot of fish?
Lots of fish, lots of seals, lots of whales, dolphins all the time.
So you're kind of jaded. This doesn't get you excited anymore.
Not anymore, no. Not after 4 years.
Well, thanks for sharing your enthusiasm with us.
Sure.
This guy's, you like your job.
Oh yeah, but I get out next week, so.
Oh, you get out of the Navy next week?
Next week.
No wonder he's so excited. He gets out in a week. Well, good luck.
Thank you very much, sir. Have a good one.
He's got a week to go. Now, what's happening here? Why is this ship, why are we so close to this ship?
Well, normally between port visits, surface ships will come up alongside an oiler and receive fuel and perhaps potable water and jet fuel while alongside. What we'll do is close to about 140 to 160 feet to start, which is where we're at right now, and throw the lines over. They actually set up rigs that go from unrev station to unrev station. That's where you see that fuel hose with the white socket attached to it, right underneath that insignia on the side of the ship. Once the lines are over and the ships can get connected, they'll open up to 160 to 180 feet, and they'll stay there for about 45 minutes to an hour until the fuel is actually transferred.
But we're not transferring fuel today.
No, what we're doing here is allowing some of the junior watchstanders to get the experience necessary to make a real live approach on an oiler.
Okay.
Because it's a lot more difficult than it seems. We're just sitting here side by side. You need to make a relatively high speed approach.
There he goes.
Another ship.
Yeah. Yay, there he goes. He got it. Come on, congratulations. And you know, that's not as easy as it looks.
No, it's not.
Have you done anything like this before?
We did it all Westpac. We were the Bolo Kings.
Really?
On Westpac.
To get it from one ship over
to the
other.
They used to do it in the olden part of the Navy.
Uh-huh.
Yes, sir. We did it all the time out there in deployment.
Now, what do you mean in the olden part of the Navy?
Back years ago, they didn't have guns to shoot. This is the only way they could get the line across to get anything replenishment-wise to another ship.
Uh-huh. They used to actually throw it.
That's correct.
Now, what are we sending over?
We're sending over what we call to the Navy is a light line, meaning that we'll be able to send them over little things like cookies or...
We're sending them cookies?
We're sending some cookies.
These are the cookies that we're sending...
We're sending a plate of cookies over to the Shiloh. Kind of,
okay, this is like a little care package being sent over.
Yes, sir, just like a little care package.
Kind of a traditional Navy thing we do, especially when we're out on deployment, we're away from home for a long time. It's nice to communicate and send things back and forth once in a while.
Now, I wonder what they're going to send us back.
Well, I don't know.
Okay, so here it goes. How does this work?
Come on.
So wait a minute, you're tying the cookies on.
Uh-huh. Tying the cookies on so we can get them across to them.
And then
They're going to pull it across.
They're going to pull the line across, and the line is long enough for it to go all the way across.
Okay.
Come on. Here we go.
Keep them dry. Let's go.
This is neat. And Tietam Cookies on the way over to the
Shiloh, our sister ship.
Oh, this is your sister ship.
It's the same type of ship as us. It's a Aegis cruiser, same as us. It's a little bit newer, but we're all sister ships.
Now, you know, standing right here, let's stand right out here because this is an amazing sight. How unusual is it to be this close at sea at this kind of speed to another ship this size?
We actually do it with ships larger than this. We get alongside the supply ships when we're at sea, and they refuel us and send us over stores. We send all kinds of things back and forth. We can put much heavier lines up, and there are even some cases where you can put a chair and send people back and forth across there.
Well, they got their music blaring out.
They sure do. It sounds like a Beach Boys concert.
It must be nice when you're at sea to have a rendezvous like this with a ship.
It's always good to see a new face or a familiar face when you're out at sea.
Yeah, good for morale.
It is good for morale. The crew likes it, and it's good practice. Right now, we're just practicing an actual unrep. Going alongside like this, it's kind of a maneuvering drill to make sure that we stay the correct distance apart, stay in a nice safe range. It's good practice for both us and for them.
How close are we? Look at this.
I don't know, what is that, 100, 150 feet, 120 feet?
Boy, that is amazing.
When we do it for real, we actually send a line across that has distance markers on it, mm-hmm. and that's we keep an exact distance across there.
Well, now they haven't sent back anything.
Hey, they're sending us the music, so
this
I guess
a one-way deal. Where's the gift from their ship?
I wish I knew.
To come down here because you wanted to show us something that very few people, very few of the civilians of our country really know the Navy is doing.
A major part of what I'm doing in Antietam and other ships are doing involves training. In fact, we spend the majority of our time training, and it takes many forms. In-rate training, that is professional training to run the ship, but lots of other kinds of training. For instance, we have right now embarked a full-time college professor who is teaching history and management courses as well as functional skills for the junior members of our crew who may not have gained all of the skills in math and English that they needed leaving high school. We do this during working hours and after working hours, and in about a month we'll also be getting computers aboard for self-paced instructional training. In addition to that, we teach a wide range of physical classroom training on automatic data processing systems, equal opportunity, and in the case of the class that's going on right now, rights and responsibilities in the Navy, which is basically a citizenship class.
Certainly. You had told me that we're just going to open up the door and let Louis just kind of look in for a second. You had told me that the idea is that a lot of people aren't going to necessarily re-enlist or make the Navy a career. So that this is a way for the Navy to help prepare them for the outside world as well.
Well, that's right, Huell. We only expect to retain about our top 30% of people for a second and beyond enlistment. And it's incumbent on us to make sure that they're ready to go back into civilian life. And to that end, we try to give them standard business skills here, an ability to use a computer. Every man on board has access to automatic data processing here. We give them college courses, we give them technical courses, apprenticeship courses if they want it. We've even certified with the American Culinary Federation 9 cooks with professional sous chef certifications, and they're prepared then to go leave the Navy and go back to civilian jobs.
So you're not just, this isn't just lip service the Navy gives to educating your people. This is a serious commitment that you're making now.
Absolutely. Over 200 members of the crew have obtained college credit courses on board. Many more have gotten GED equivalency if they didn't finish their high school diploma, and other guys have been able to improve their skill levels such that it improves their ability to be promoted if they decide to stay in the Navy.
So when you're at sea, there's something for them to do other than sit around when they're not on duty. They can be in the classroom.
There's almost always something to do, and we even run movies on our site television for those guys who finish their homework.
You are one for tradition, aren't you?
Well, I think so. I'm a Naval Academy graduate and was steeped in 4 years of tradition there, and then I've served with some officers who were great traditionalists and gave me a lot of that, particularly in my two battleships, the battleship Missouri most recently during the Desert War.
Because, I mean, there are a lot of traditions that you're continuing to carry on board your ship, as well as all the new, modern, exciting things you have going on here. There's a lot of that sense of continuity of history and tradition here as well.
That's very important to binding the crew and putting them in a perspective of over 200 years of naval tradition, naval history, naval courage, and if they ever have to, being able to carry out the best aspects of naval warfare.
Okay, we have come safely into port. I don't know how to thank you. This has been absolutely wonderful. It's certainly a lot different from the first way we saw the ship there in dry dock in Long Beach.
Well, Huell, I'm glad you could see the before and the after, and we appreciate the interest of you and the public TV viewers of California.
Do you really think the average person understands what goes on aboard one of these ships?
Probably not, because it is a very different lifestyle. It's a very different kind of society in many ways, although we take people from all over the United States and from all kinds of backgrounds. It is its own little city here and its own little lifestyle.
Well, we have thoroughly enjoyed the day. We're all, you've given both Luis and myself one of these official hats, so I guess we're honorary crew members now.
That's right. You certainly are honorary crew members and experienced crew members since you've been here twice, both in the industrial period and in the underway period.
Well, thank you very much. I'm going to disembark because I know you're leaving here and heading back up to L.A., aren't
you? In just a few minutes, we're going to get back underway, go out and meet up with an oiler and take some fuel, and then go back to Los Angeles, our home port.
As you said, there is never a dull moment on board the Antietam.
Something going on all the time. Thanks for coming, Huell.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
We're off.
There ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the U.S.
Visiting with Huell Hauser is made possible through a generous grant from the Ralph M. Parsons Foundation.